Well, good morning and welcome to Inverness Christian Fellowship. It's so great that you have taken some time to connect with us, and we just pray that God would bless you and make his presence known to you as you share with us on whatever social media platform you are using today. Today we are continuing our devoted series, and I'll be bringing God's word a little bit later on, and we've also got Jeannie praying and Ruth reading.
Yeah, we do. Looking forward to that. Just before we get into time of worship, what a great song that was just to start the service off as well, wasn't
absolutely.
It?
Absolutely,
really
amen.
Good. And it's true, his promise still stands.
Absolutely.
Great is his faithfulness. And I just want to read something that's really encouraged me this week. It's been, I find this week really quite tough. It's been a hard week. I don't know about you, if you find it tough. I find it a difficult week this week. But this Psalm 116, just the beginning of it, really, really encouraged me this week. I love the Lord because he hears my voice and my prayer for mercy. Because he bends down to listen, I will pray as long as I have breath. Wow. He listens to the cry of my heart. He listens to the cry of your heart. He listens. And I love that picture that he bends down to listen. He cares.
Really good.
And that's just really blessed me and encouraged me this week.
Yeah, I mean, the Psalms are such a source of blessing to us. Yes, there are lots of Psalms that explain about God's thanks and praise and worship, but the reality is that the majority of the Psalms are about the cry of our hearts and how God hears us, and we can cry out to him to come to our rescue. Mm. And so I love that picture as well, that he bends down to listen. Lovely.
Yeah, it's great, isn't it? We're going to have a time of worship in a moment, and we just want to say thank you very much to the Barn Church, who have helped us and facilitated and opened their doors for us to be able to record worship social distanced, using all the correct guidelines. But we just want to say thank you to our friends at the Barn Church. And just before we go into a time of worship, let's pray, will we? And let's kind of adopt a position of worship, of openness. Perhaps you want to stand in readiness, or just open your arms and just receive. Yeah. And as we just connect with the King of Kings, you know, this isn't a show, this isn't a television program for you to watch. This is something that we all have to enter in. We all have to do something in order to get something back. So let's just be in that position of openness as we connect with the King of Kings this morning. So Father, we thank you and we welcome you this morning. We welcome you into our homes, and Father, we welcome you into this service. And Father, we thank you for that truth that we have read this morning in the Psalm. Father, that you hear the cry of our hearts, and all of us watching this morning, all of us connecting, we all have a different cry of our hearts, and you hear every single one. And we thank you for that, Father. And just now, as we worship, as we sing praise unto your name, and as we carry on doing the service and hear from your word, Father, I pray that you would give us ears to listen. Father, that we'd be able to sing praise to your name, Father, in freedom. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You teach that faith is hard. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are unchanging. You are the same now as you have always been, and you will always be the same. Because of this, we have a sure and steadfast hope in you as our stronghold and our deliverer. We thank you, Lord, for the wonderful, amazing salvation from sin and death that you have provided for us through the precious blood of our Saviour Jesus. Never let us lose sight of how awesome and incredible, how powerful and all-encompassing Jesus' sacrifice and the triumph of the cross is for us who believe. Thank you that even in a time of great trouble, we can welcome your truth with the joy supplied by the Holy Spirit, for we know that your unfailing love for us cannot be shaken, and we can trust in you with total confidence. So as we come to your word, Father, we ask that you will speak clearly into our hearts and lives, that your Holy Spirit will make the word of life refreshing and invigorating to our souls, to the praise of your glory. In the name that is above every name, the magnificent name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Last week, we began looking at what it means to be devoted to the breaking of bread by focusing our attention on the cross. For by better understanding all that Christ has achieved for us on the cross, we can better remember all that he accomplished for us through his body given and his blood shed on the cross. Now, there are dozens and dozens of New Testament passages that give reasons why Jesus came to die. And John Piper in 2006 wrote a book called 50 Reasons Why Jesus Came to Die. And he says it's the most concerted focus of anything he has written on the reasons for the cross. And his reasons for writing it were to enable his readers to expand and deepen and intensify their love for what Jesus accomplished. Now, I am nowhere near the standard of John Piper, but his reasons for writing that book resonate within me as we take some time to go deeper into what Christ accomplished for us on the cross. As we focus our hearts on what he has accomplished for us, our heart is that we may, as Paul wrote to the Ephesians in chapter 3, he says, to that we may grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that we may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. And God is love. And so we are praying that we may be filled with a love for the Lord that comes through knowing Christ and that goes beyond just our head knowledge, but into all of our experience in all of our lives. And the foundation of our love for him is his demonstration of his love for us through the cross. Isaac Watts penned one of the best loved hymns of all times, where he wrote, "When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died." So as we survey the wondrous cross, let's turn to the words of Paul in the book of Romans in chapter 3 and verses 9 through 26. And today, Ruth, with the help of her granddaughter, is going to read this to us.
The reading this morning is from Romans chapter 3, verses 9 to 26. What shall we conclude then? Do we have any advantage? Not at all. For we have already made the charge that Jews and Gentiles alike are all under the power of sin. As it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have altogether become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. Their throats are open graves, their tongues practice deceit. The poison of vipers is on their lips, and their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood, ruin and misery mark their ways, and the way of peace they do not know. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world held accountable to God. Therefore, no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by the words of the law. Rather, through the law, we become conscious of our sin. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Jesus Christ. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Ruth, and thank you to your granddaughter, and may God add a blessing to the reading of his word. The key verse that I'd like us to focus on today is found in verses 25 and 26 of the passage that we've just read, where it says, God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood. That is quite a statement. And according to the Oxford English Dictionary, the word atonement means the action of making amends for a wrong or injury. In religious context, it says it means reparation or expiation for sin. But what is sin? We've already said that God is a God of love. And God loves us. He loves you and he loves me unconditionally. And his desire is that we love him in return. In Deuteronomy 6:5, God's law demands to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Jesus said to those who would follow him in John 15, verse 14, if you love me, you'll keep my commands. And back in the Garden of Eden, God, in his love, placed Adam and Eve in a place of perfection. They were in a place where they had an abundance of choice, where they knew no shame, and where they enjoyed living in the presence of God. There was only one thing that God asked them to not to do, and that was not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And God loved Adam and Eve and enjoyed relationship with them. And that one command that he gave them was to see how much they loved him in return, to follow the commands of the one who had given them life. But Adam and Eve did the one thing that God asked them not to. They ate from that tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Yes, they were tempted and they tried to push the blame onto away from themselves. And that's the first thing that sin does, is it blames someone or something else. But the fact is that they loved that fruit from the forbidden tree more than they loved God and his instruction. And all the way through time, mankind has made a choice to love other things more than God and his instructions. And that's what sin is. It's dishonoring God by preferring other things over him and acting on those preferences. Which is why verse 23 of our reading says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Sin is ugly. It's described for us in the passage that we read through verses 13 through 18. It's not a pleasant description. Sin is not a small thing. Mankind has sinned and sin is ugly and God cannot abide it. It's not what God purposed when he made mankind, but this is what mankind has chosen. As I said, sin is not a small thing because it's not against a small God. It's against the creator of the universe. The one who created all things ought to be worthy of our respect, our adoration, our loyalty, our love. But in our sin, we have in effect committed treason against who God created us to be. In our failure to love him and love by loving other things, we have defamed God and destroyed our own reason for being. God is a God of love, but he is also holy and he is just. And because he is just, he cannot overlook the sin and say, oh well, they're just human. He cannot sweep the sin under the carpet. The treason of our sin against God has to be punished by him. God told Adam in Genesis 2:17, you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat from it, you will certainly die. And Adam, who became a living soul when God breathed life into him, you see, we are more than just body. We are, our souls are living. And at that point that Adam sinned against God, Adam chose a path that would result in death. At that point in time, in the Garden of Eden, death was something that was unknown. But as we all now know, there is nothing more sure than our physical death. It will happen to each one of us in some time, in some place, in some way. Paul says in Romans 6 verse 23, for the wages of sin is death. Sin deserves to be punished. For God not to punish sin would be unjust. If God did not punish sin, then it would demean God. If God did not punish sin, then him being a just God could not be believed. And if that was not true, then we could also not believe that God is love or holy or righteous. God has said in Galatians 3:10, quoting from the book of Deuteronomy, that cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. There is a curse over mankind who sin against God. It's serious. Sin has to be punished by the one against whom we have sinned. Our sin deserved to be punished by God, who is just. But here is some wonderful news. God, in his love, does not rest with the curse that hangs over sinful mankind. God did not just fold his arms and say, stuff the lot here. Once you physically die, you can stand before me and I'll dish out my wrath of judgment on your soul for all eternity. And as a just God, he's certainly entitled to do that, because we are the criminals before him. We are guilty as charged. But God in his love doesn't desire that, because you see, he loves mankind. He loves you and I unconditionally, and he desires a relationship with us. He wants us to be who he created us to be. He wants our souls to live with him forever. And because God so loved the world, because he loved us, he gave us Jesus, his only begotten Son. Back to Romans 3 verse 25, God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood. As I said before, according to the Oxford English Dictionary, the word atonement means the action of making amends or for a wrong or an injury. And to make amends for the wrong done to God by us, God presented Jesus. And ever since Adam sinned against God, God was telling us the story of how he would do this. When Adam and Eve sinned, an animal had to die so that God could make garments of skin to cover up Adam and Eve's nakedness, to cover up their shame. The nation of Israel, on an annual basis, on the Day of Atonement, had to perform a ceremony to cleanse the nation from their sin, two goats were presented. One was sacrificed as a sin offering, recognizing that the punishment of sin is death, and the other had the hands of the priests laid on top of the goat's head, and all the sins of the nation were confessed and effectively placed on that goat. And that was sent away outside of the camp. In effect, it became a scapegoat, symbolizing that once the sin offering was made, the sins of the nation were effectively removed from the camp. And Jesus came to be the sin offering and the scapegoat for all of mankind's sin, once for all. 2 Corinthians 5:21 said, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us. Romans 3:25, again, God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of blood to be received by faith. In the shedding of Jesus' blood, Jesus became that sin offering, taking the punishment that God's justice demanded. Sin deserved death, and all of our sin was placed on him, and he died for our sin. And if we confess our sin, recognizing that it was all placed upon him, then Jesus also becomes our scapegoat. For as Psalm 103 verse 12 says, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. And yes, it takes faith to believe it. But as Romans 3:25 says, God presented Christ as that sacrifice of atonement for us to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. You see, sin has to be punished. For those who lived before Christ, they required faith to believe in the Messiah who would take away their sin. And for those who live after Christ, they require faith to believe in the Messiah who took away their sin. For those who lived before Christ, the punishment for their sin was paid for by Jesus on the cross through their faith looking forward to the cross. And for those who live after Christ, the punishment for their sin, which is effectively our sin, was paid for by Jesus on the cross through our faith looking back to the cross. You see, the cross is central. God's wrath against sin is satisfied once for all through Jesus who died on the cross. And as God who is just, he has demonstrated that he is righteous, because the wages of sin have been satisfied in death, satisfied in the death of Jesus. John Piper says, if God were not just, there would be no demand for his son to suffer and die. And if God were not loving, there would be no willingness for his son to suffer and die. But God is both just and loving. Therefore, his love is willing to meet the demands of his justice. In effect, God offers through Jesus the removal of God's wrath over us by providing us a substitute. And the substitute is provided by God himself. The substitute, Jesus Christ, does not cancel the wrath. He absorbs it and diverts it from us to himself. God's wrath is just, and it was spent, not withdrawn. Again, to quote from John Piper, we will never stand in awe of being loved by God until we reckon with the seriousness of our sin and the justice of his wrath against us. But when, by grace we waken to our unworthiness, then we may look at the suffering and death of Christ and say, in this is love. Not that we have loved God, but that he has loved us and sent his Son to be the wrath-absorbing propitiation for our sins. So to bring this to a conclusion, Romans 3 verse 26 says, he did this to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Those who have faith in Jesus are justified. Being justified before God and being forgiven by God are not identical. We will talk about forgiveness a bit more next week. But suffice to say that being forgiven implies that I am guilty and my crime is not counted. Being justified implies that I have been tried and found innocent. Justifying is a legal act. It means declaring someone to be just. It is a verdict. The verdict of justification does not make a person just. It declares a person just. It is based on someone actually being just. That's why Romans 3:26 says the one who is just, that is God, is the one who justifies those who are in Christ Jesus. So when we have faith in Christ Jesus, when we believe that he took the wrath of God for our sin, we are justified. We are in effect declared not guilty, just as if we have never sinned. Wow! Wow! What about you today? Do you have faith in Jesus? God has presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement for us through the shedding of his blood on the cross, but it requires faith in Jesus. Faith in what he did for on the cross for us. It requires faith to avail ourselves of what God has presented to us. Jesus himself said in John 3:36, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains on them. I said before that we're not just a physical body. God breathed into us a living soul, and when our bodies die, which is a direct consequence of our sin, then our soul lives on. And God's word said in Hebrews 9 verse 27, just as people are destined to die once and after that face the judgment, so if we have not received by faith what God offers to us in Jesus, then when we die, the wrath of God remains on us and we will face the full punishment of God for our sin for all eternity because we rejected what God presented to us in Christ on the cross. But if we do receive by faith what God offers to us in Jesus, then that wrath is removed because we receive the truth that Jesus paid it for us, for all of our sin and for all eternity, because when we come before God in judgment after we die, then we are declared not guilty and we enter into the paradise of God and live with him forever. What about you today? Do you have faith in Christ? If you don't have that faith in him, or are uncertain or used to a long time ago, and today you want to accept or rededicate your life to Jesus based on what he has done for you on the cross, then I'd like just to say a prayer and you can pray this along with me. The words will come up on the screen. So let's pray. Loving and just God, thank you for sending Jesus to take your wrath against my sin. I'm sorry for what I've done wrong against you. Please forgive me. Come into my life and make me new. I put my faith and trust in Jesus. Thank you that I am now declared not guilty before you. Help me to live for you and show the love you've revealed to me to others. In Jesus' name, amen. And if you prayed that prayer, I just want to welcome you into God's family. There are angels rejoicing in heaven. You are now a child of God, and we'd love to be able to connect with you and to help you in your next steps in this adventure with following God. And you can contact us on the email address that's on the screen now. And our prayer for all of you who do know that faith in Christ, whether it's just been received or whether that faith has been in your heart for many years, can I just encourage you all at this time just to thank the Lord, thank God for Jesus, for his sacrifice of atonement, who took the wrath of God for us, and through confession of our sin and faith in his sacrifice, he has removed our sin and we are declared not guilty before him. When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. Amen.
So thank you very much, Robbie, and indeed the perfect hymn just to seal that. And to sing that is just wonderful, wonderful, great promise and all he has done for us.
Yeah,
and it's wonderful just going over it again and reminding ourselves.
Not guilty.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
And you've done some questions?
I've done some questions, and we'll get these out to the Connect Life groups. And if you're not part of the Connect Life group, then again, we would encourage you to get involved in one, and because they're great opportunities just to share and dig deeper into God's word and have fellowship together, which is so important in these days.
Yeah, absolutely. Growing together and growing deeper, it's great. Mm-hmm. Really good. Also, this evening there is a next leadership session from the Apostolic Church. That was a bit of a mouthful. But that's on this evening. If you are in any form of church leadership, whether it's Sunday school or, do you know what, even if you're doing the tea and coffee, whatever, or usually, we've not done that for nearly a year, wow. But any form of church leadership you're interested in, or if you just like to know more, then you can watch tonight. There's a live stream from the Apostolic Church, and Sunny Hill are facilitating all of that, aren't they?
They are indeed.
So you can watch it on the Apostolic Church website, Facebook page, which is on the screen now.
Yes.
Or on the Sunny Hill YouTube channel, which is on the screen now. Thank you, Rob. So you can watch that and join in tonight.
Yeah. And this coming week as well, as part of the National Apostolic Church, we are joining with the rest of the nation in a week of prayer and fasting. And if you're able to commit to a day when you can pray and fast, then please let us know, because we'd love to have all the days covered within our own fellowship, as well as obviously the other churches will be doing similar. But if you need more information about what each day is focusing on and a little bit more information, then we have that, and you can get in touch with us by contacting us on our email address here.
Yeah, those on our mailing list will have already received all that information. So looking forward to that.
Yes.
Yeah, so kettle time now. So time to pop the kettle on, and we will meet together in Zoom and go off into some breakout rooms and share together, and just let's be honest with each other. How's your week been? How's it really been? And just spend a bit of time together. So if you're watching on online.church live, then you will see the button pop up, and you can just click that button, and that will take you into Zoom. If you're watching on Facebook, then please personal message us if you don't already have our details, our Zoom details, because we'd love to meet with you and have a chat and just see how things are.
Yeah. So let's just close with the benediction. So then may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each one of you, now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you. Stay safe, and we'll see you back here very soon.